Okay, so I'm gonna start my class on stability result for functional inequalities. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to this beautiful place. It's nice to wake up and see the sea. So the purpose of my class is to investigate some geometric and functional inequalities. Some classical results like, for instance, the superimmetric inequality. And first of all, show you how you can prove such inequalities, and then understand how to understand whether these inequalities are stable and how to prove stability. So at the beginning, I want to start from the very beginning. So what I'm going to do is to present you the superimmetric inequality now. And then I'm going to try to give you a kind of the classical proof of the superimmetric inequality, so back to the 50s. So for some people who are kind of expert in the area, this first part can be a bit boring, but I think it's interesting to see how to do this stuff. So isoperimmetric inequality. So the isoperimmetric inequality is the following. Let's say that I have some domain E in Rn. Let's assume for a moment that the set is bounded and smooth. Let's say open. And what the supermetric quality says is that we can control the volume of the set E through the surface measure, so the perimeter of E, so this is the perimeter, controls up to a constant, and the optimal constant is the following, n times the measure of the unit ball to the power 1 over n, measure of E, n minus 1 over n. So the perimeter controls the volume up to a constant, and actually this inequality is sharp. You have equality whenever, actually if and only if, E is a ball. So if E is a smooth set, you can define the perimeter in tons of ways. You can think, I mean, this is just you parameterize locally the boundary, and you just compute the surface area, and then you integrate, and you find the total perimeter. So for a smooth set, the notion of perimeter is kind of not difficult, but I want to give a more general definition of perimeter. And let me point out that this inequality, of course, is scaling invariant. It must be, otherwise it could have been true, which means the following, that so if you change the set E by lambda E, then what happens is that the perimeter scale, like, so the perimeter change with a factor lambda to the n minus 1, while the volume change with a factor lambda to the n. So if you take a set and you dilate, the perimeter is multiplied by lambda to the n minus 1, the volume is multiplied by lambda to the n. But then because of this power, you will see that the factor lambda cancel each other, which is natural. Okay, so now the first question is, how can I prove such an inequality? So we want to prove this. And so the goal is to prove the superimmetric inequality. So I know that last week, Guido gave a proof of this inequality using mass transport. I'm going to come back to that proof most likely in the next lecture, which I think is tomorrow. But at the moment, I want to just stick to the classical. So I will give a more geometric proof of this inequality. So first of all, without loss of generality, I can always assume, let's say, that the volume of E is 1. Just take the set and dilate it, make it volume 1. And so what is our goal? So to prove it, since now this number is fixed, this 1, what you want to prove is that the perimeter of a set of measure 1 is always greater or equal than this constant. So our goal is prove that the perimeter of E is always greater than a dimensional constant, which is this one. How can we prove this? Well, so the strategy is kind of a classical problem in the calculus of variation. So we want to minimize the perimeter of E among all sets E such that measure of E equal 1. So it's just a minimization problem. You say I take all the sets of volume 1 and I want to minimize the perimeter. So up to now, I didn't even define what the perimeter is when the set is kind of a general Borel set, let's say. So for the moment, since I didn't say, let's say E is still smooth. In some sense, I could say I just want to minimize among smooth sets. So what's the strategy when you have a problem like this? There is what is called the direct method of the calculus of variation. So the direct method consists just in the following. First of all, you say, let's take a minimizing sequence. So I want to understand this problem. So I'm going to take a sequence EK, volume EK equal 1, such that the perimeter of EK converge to the infimum of the perimeter of E among all sets with volume 1. So you consider this number, the minimum possible, is an infimum at the moment because we don't know that there exists a minimizer, you just take a minimizing sequence. And then you would like to prove, so up to subsequences, you want to prove that EK converge in some sense to some set E infinity. I use this abbreviation, subsequences, or without loss of generality. If some of them are not clear, just let me know. So up to that sequences, we get that they converge to some set infinity. And then what you want to prove is that, prove two things. First of all, that the volume of E infinity is still 1. Oh, sorry. So that this is still an abysmal set. And then that the perimeter of the set E infinity is less or equal than the Lie-Manf over K of the perimeter of EK. And since this Lie-Manf was equal to the infimum, equal 1, I'm worried that if I write 2 down, some people in the back are not going to see, so I'm going to be avoid to write 2 down. I apologize for this time. So you see that if I can prove that the volume is still 1 and the perimeter is lower semi-continuous, then I found my minimizer, because my perimeter is less or equal than the infimum, so it must be equal to the infimum, so I got my minimizer. So this is the strategy. Now there are several issues in this argument, because at the moment I just have smooth sets, and it's very difficult if you take, for instance, a minimizing sequence, first of all, show that you're going to extract a subsequence. You need some compactness. And then here, you have to prove slower semi-continuity for the perimeter. And still I didn't define exactly what is the perimeter for a general set, but you can just think again the smooth surface area, but then it's not obvious how to prove that. So what do you do when you have such a problem? The first thing you want to do sometimes is to enlarge the class of sets, of admissible sets. So maybe, let me, cancel here. So before giving this definition, let me just make an analogy. This is kind of, so just analogy, which maybe most of you already saw. When you want to minimize the Dirichlet integral. So when you minimize the integral, let's say, of gradius square, let's say with U infinity. So you would like to minimize the integral of the gradient of a function squared among all smooth functions which have some bounded E equal G on the boundary of omega. In general, you're not going to be able to find a minimizer among infinity functions. If you try, it's difficult to find prove that there exists a minimizer in infinity because you don't have enough compactness in infinity. So what do? You say, OK, I don't know how to do this. I move to Sobolev classes, so I minimize the integral of gradius square not amongst infinity functions, but among functions which are just W12, U equal G on the boundary of omega, you prove that a minimizer exists in that class. And then you prove that if U bar is a minimizer, then U bar is infinity. And this is like regularity for harmonic function. You prove that the minimizer is harmonic, and you prove that it's infinity. So now it doesn't really matter, this part I don't want to discuss. I'm just saying, maybe some of you already saw this kind of procedure where you relax the problem, you find a minimizer in a bigger class, in this case W12, and then actually you prove that your minimizer was in the smaller class, it's infinity. So we're going to do something analogous. We're going to enlarge the class, so not only smooth sets, even if we know that the minimizer is a smooth set, it's a ball. And then find the minimizer there. Okay, so definition of perimeter. How can we define the perimeter of a set? So definition of perimeter. The definition of perimeter, let's try to do an heuristic. So let's say that let E be smooth. By smooth, let's say boundary of E is infinity. Then what I can say, so the perimeter of E is, well, the integral on the boundary of the function 1 with respect to some surface measure, by definition, if you want, is the integral 1. So it's the total mass, it's the total area of the surface measure. Okay, but now 1, for sure, is equal if I consider the sup over all vector field, so all x from Rn into Rn, x of class C1, modulus of x less or equal than 1, and then here I replace 1 by the scalar product between x and the normal, d sigma. So it's clear that this quantity is less or equal than this one, just because x is less or equal than 1, the normal is less or equal than 1, so the scalar product here is less or equal than 1. But actually, you have equality, because you can just take x to be equal to nu on the boundary of E. So you have your set, which is a smooth set. You have your nu of E is the exterior normal. And locally, you can find a smooth, let's say, C1 vector field, which is equal to the normal on the boundary. So it's you take the normal, you extend it in a small tuberal neighborhood, and then with a cutoff function, you put it to 0. And in this way, you get that this quantity is equal to this quantity. But now, once you look at this expression, you can recognize that this is just the flux of the vector field on the boundary. So I can rewrite this as the sup over x, C1. So capital X will always be a vector field for me. Modulus of x less or equal than 1. The integral over E of the divergence of X. And now since I put the derivative on X, you see that this is actually a definition which makes sense for every set E. And actually, just to make sure that the integral still converges, let me maybe gain 1 centimeter more. So this is the same if I do by density the sup over X, which is C1 and compactly supported. So by little c, I mean compactly supported. Anyhow, the space of X, which are compact with C1, compactly supported, is dense in the other space. And then you just put divergence again. So all the sups are the same. So you see that this is E. So you see that this last formula, sup, this makes sense for every Borel set, because this is a continuous function, and they're just integrating over a Borel set, a continuous function. And then I take a supremum. So now this justifies the definition to use this last formula as a definition of perimeter. And this is what the Georgi did around 60 years ago. So definition. This is the one, let's say, adopted by the Georgi. So we are in the 50s. Let E be a Borel set then we define P of E to be, by definition, the supremum x, c1, and compactly supported, modulus of x less or equal than 1, of the integral over E of the divergence of x. And we say that E has finite perimeter, perimeter if this number P of E is finite. So this is a supremum, it could be plus infinity, it's going to be plus infinity for very rough sets, but whenever it's finite, we say that our set has finite perimeter. So now we have a definition of perimeter, and the good thing is that this definition gives a lot of nice properties. So what I want to show now is that with this definition, you have lower semi-continuity of the perimeter. The perimeter along sequence can only go down. And you have compactness of sets, which are the two properties I needed to prove existence of minimizers. So, first thing, lower semi-continuity. So, on this first part, I will try to give some proofs, also for people who are not used to this setting. And then as we move on, I will maybe skip some argument and just give sketches. But at least for these first two properties, I will give the proofs. Two or three properties. So lower semi-continuity. So the lemma is the following. If EK converges in L1 lock to a set E, and by this I mean that, so I will use this notation to say that the characteristic function of EK converges in L1 lock to the characteristic function of E. Okay. So the characteristic function is just the function which is one inside, right? Key means one in E and zero outside E. Sometimes characteristic function use zero infinity, so I just wanted to fix the notation. So if EK converges to E in L1 lock, then the perimeter of E is less or equal than the Lie-Manf of the perimeter of EK. Maybe everything is plus infinity, but you still have lower semi-continuity. And the proof is one line. It's just the following, that for every x, c1 vector field, modulus of x less or equal than 1, we have that the integral over E of the divergence of x is equal to c1 and compactly supported, is equal to the limit over k of the integral over ek of the divergence of x. So this follows by the L1 log convergence. This sets converge to this, so this integral converge. And now this is less or equal. So remember, the definition of perimeter is the, for every ek, the perimeter is the supremum of these quantities among all set pk. So this is less than the perimeter. So this is less than pk. Each of these quantity is less than the perimeter of EK, and then I can just put Lie-Manf here. Because this is less or equal than this pointwise as a number. So we have that this Lie-Manf is greater or equal than this quantity, and now X is arbitrary. So then just take the sup over X, over capital X. So just you have this Lie-Manf is greater or equal than this, you take the sup over X, you get the perimeter. So this proves the lower semi-continuity If you have questions, please interrupt me. Yeah. Sorry? Limanth? Here? Well, here I don't know that there exists a limit. So this is just a, so this is, this, I know that is a limit and is equal to this because they set EK are converging in L1 to E. So this is a limit. Now I'm just saying for every fixed K, this quantity is less or equal than this one. So it means that the Limanth of this, which always exists, is greater or equal than the Limanth of this. But this is a limit because there is, because I already know that it's a limit. So I could have, I could write here Limanth if you want, just to, it's the same. In general, I mean, I don't know if this is a limit, so this is why I have to take a Limanth. I could take a Limsup, but it will get a worse information, so it's stupid to take a Limsup. Okay, so this is the first property. And now, really here, we'll do, so for people who knows, this is probably a bit boring, but let me do also very briefly the regularization argument. So I want to show that if you give me a set of finite perimeter, I can always approximate it with smooth functions. The argument is very elementary. So lemma, if E is bounded, I'm just going to consider the bounded case, anyhow, this is what I'm going to use. Then I can find a sequence U epsilon is infinity, and actually compactly supported in a Ren, such that U epsilon converge in L1 to the characteristic of E, and the integral of the gradient of U epsilon over Rn converge to the perimeter of U. So I'm saying that I can always approximate sets with smooth functions, and you see by this that in some sense the perimeter is morally speaking the integral of the gradient, the L1 norm of the gradient of the function. So I'm saying that these are similar. The idea is this. So if you take a set E, smooth set, how can you approximate with the smooth functions? In some sense, instead of having an interface 1, 0, you just do a smooth interface here in an epsilon neighborhood. So you do a smooth transition between 1 and 0. And if you do a construction like this, so that's just the rough, the geometric idea. If you do an interface between E1 and 0 in a smooth way, and you compute what is the integral of the gradient of a function like this, roughly speaking, the gradient is going to be all in this direction, and you can check that the integral of the gradient, roughly speaking, is proportional to the area, because you get, well, I mean, I hope it's, in some sense, the picture from the side here would be something like this. Over a width epsilon, you have a 1, 0, the derivative 1 of the epsilon. Here, the slope is 1 over epsilon, so when you integrate the gradient, you have the integral over this tube. And the gradient is over the 1 over epsilon, and the area of this is perimeter of E times epsilon. So this is kind of a picture illustrating this, but let me give the proof, which is actually completely formal. It's pure computation. So how can you regularize a set? Just convolve. So take rho epsilon C infinity in compactly supported convolution kernels. So a smooth function which converge to a delta. And just define U epsilon to be characteristic of E convolution rho epsilon. So if you want, the easiest thing you can come up with works. That's good. And then with this, I claim that this satisfies all the properties. and the argument is also very simple. So, first of all, U epsilon converge to the characteristic of V. Well, this is a classical fact. You can prove as an exercise. If you take a characteristic of a function, you convolve with smooth. When epsilon goes to zero, this converges to the KD. Now, there are two inequalities. One is the same as before. So take, I'm going to take, so again, now, take x to be C1 and compactly supported, x less or equal than 1. So in one case, I have that the integral over E divergence of x is equal to the limit over epsilon of U epsilon divergence of x. Just as before, this converges to this. And now here, you can integrate by parts. These are smooth, compactly supported functions. So this is the limit epsilon goes to 0 of minus the integral of grad U epsilon scalar product with x. Here we are on Rn. And now x has modulus less or equal than 1. So this quantity is for sure less than the gradient of the integral of the modulus. And so I get the Lim inequality. So that's less than Lim over epsilon going to 0 of grad epsilon. So in this way, I get, and then you take the sup over x. So for every x, I have that this is less than the Lim, sup over x give one inequality. So it tells me that the Lim of this is greater or equal than PD. So by this, we get P less or equal Lim of integral of grad U epsilon. How to get the other one? That's just by using the property of the convolutions. Convolution decreases norms. And in this case, I will just do by putting the convolution kernel on the x. So let's go back to this formula here. Let me do it moving from there, probably. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to start now from here. So minus the integral. So I want to prove the opposite inequality. Minus the integral of grad u epsilon dot x. Again, this is the integral of u epsilon divergence x. And what is u epsilon? This is the integral of key convolution rho epsilon divergence x. Okay. Now the convolution, when you have three functions, you can always move the convolution from one to the other. If you take an even kernel, if it's not even, you have to change inside. Let's say that this is even. So I can move the convolution from here to here. So this is the same as characteristic of E times divergence of X convolution rho epsilon. And now the divergence and the convolution commute, derivative is a convolution commute. So this is the same as integral key of E divergence of X convolution rho epsilon. And now this is nothing else than the integral of E of the divergence of X convolution rho epsilon. But this now is C1 and compactly supported. And the modulus of X convolution rho epsilon is still less or equal than 1. Because if you take a vector field which has modulus less or equal than 1, you convolve it, the modulus remains less or equal than 1. The norms do not increase. It's an average. So this is less than the perimeter of E, because the perimeter of E is the supremum. So perimeter of E is greater or equal than this for every x. And so by taking the sup over x, we get, so here I have perimeter of E, I get that the integral of grad u epsilon is less or equal than p of E for every epsilon. But this proves the opposite inequality, because I have that this Lie MUF is greater or equal, but each of them is less or equal than the other one, so they converge. So for every time I have this inequality. Okay. So, questions? It's clear? Okay, why did I do this? Because now I want to prove compactness. And for the compactness proof, I'm going to use a Poincaré inequality. And in some sense, every time you have an inequality for functions, by this by the fact that you can approximate sets of finite perimeter by smooth functions, you can pass the inequality to the sets. And this is what I'm going to do. So compactness is the following. No. I know that sometimes I write a bit fast, so if you feel that you need a bit more time sometimes to copy, let me know. I know this from my students in Austin. But it's not useful if you tell me at the end of the week that I was writing too fast. So, lemma. So I consider a family EK in Rn, a sequence of sets, and I'm going to assume that the perimeter of EK is bounded by a constant capital M, uniformly, so for every K. And I'm going to assume that my sets are uniformly bounded. So let's say EK are contained in some ball B of R for some R greater than zero. So I have a family of sets which are bounded, and perimeter is uniformly bounded. Then there exists a subsequence, EKJ, converging in L1 to some set E, and E, of course, is still contained in BR. Okay, so what I'm saying is that if you give me a set, a family of sets of finite perimeter, which are uniformly bounded, and whose perimeters are uniformly bounded, then this family is pre-compact in L1. Up to such sequences, they converge in L1 to some set E. Of course, this set E is going to contain in BR, and then by the lower semi-continuity, this property will still pass, will also be true. But this is just the compactness. So I've been thinking for a while whether I wanted to do this, but I'm going to give the proof exactly because I think it's nice if you have never seen sets of finite perimeter. I think this is one of the main reasons why sets of finite perimeter are useful. I mean, all this definition of perimeter is useful because you have compactness. And then once you have compactness, you can prove existence of minimizers. And once you have existence of minimizer, then you can work with the minimizer. So this proof is not like the previous ones. It's not just one line of computation with the right Lie MUF. It is a slightly longer argument. So, proof. So the first thing. Yeah, the sets must always be bounded. Yeah, the reason why you want that to be bounded is because otherwise you could have a family of sets of finite perimeter which escape to infinity. Just take a ball and start to translate it. Then this ball just escape at infinity and the limit you don't get anything. You can always have compactness in L1 lock. But if your sets are not bounded, you cannot ensure that the mass is conserved. Exactly, because just take balls which convert to infinity and the limit you get the empty set. So the mass could escape. That's why you need a boundedness. So, first step is the Poincaré inequality. So this one I'm going to give it for granted, and I can give you a reference for the proof. It's really two lines. It's by Fubini. So for every unit cube, let's say Q1, so I take a cube in Rn, I have that the integral over Q1 of a function u minus its average over the cube is bounded by dimensional constant cn integral over q1 of the gradient of u. It is true for every u in c1, sorry, of the cube. So you take, give me a c1 function on the cube, the integral of the gradient over q1 controls the L1 norm of u, but you see that you have to subtract an average. Because if you didn't have this, you could just take the function u to be a constant, and then here you will get zero, while this will not be zero if you didn't subtract the average. So the reason why you subtract the average is exactly to kill the constants. Once you kill the constants, then this inequality is true. So the gradient is controlling the function in L1. Now, what happens, so this inequality is in Q1. Now I want to put it in a cube QR, a small cube. If I want to go to a small cube, so now given, so now let V, for instance, be a function which is C1C in QR, where QR is a cube of side R. So you have now a small cube QR. And you want to write the analogous inequality in a smaller cube. How do you do? You take V, you rescale V to Q1, apply the inequality, and go back. So let V be in Q1, QR be a cube. Define U of X to be V of Rx. In this way, U is C1. Sorry, there is no compactly support. U is now is C1 in Q1. And then you apply Poincaré. To U, and then go back to V. I let you do this as an exercise. So you just define U in this way, plug the inequality, and then just do the change of variable to go back to the cube QR. And what you get, okay, well, I can just keep going with this. There is a gonna be an R popping out. Go back to V, and we get that the average, sorry, the integral over QR of V minus the average of V is less or equal than Cn, same constant. And now we have a R in front, the integral over QR of the gradient of V. So when you go from a cube of scale 1 to a cube of scale R, you get an R in front. This is by dimensional reason. Here you have gradient, which is like 1 over length, and you need a length in front to match the dimensions. So this is the inequality. And now I want to apply this inequality not to C1 function, but to sets of finite perimeter. So how do I do this? So now two, let U first be a function, which is C1, C in Rn now. Take a grid of side R in Rn. So you take Rn and you divide it in cubes of side little r. And then on each of these cubes, we're going to apply this inequality. So what I have is that the integral over Rn of the gradient of u, well, this is the sum over h of the integral over qh of the gradient of u. So I'm going to call qh this family of cubes. These are cubes of side r. And now on each qr, I apply this inequality. So I get... So this, I put it here as a denominator, so 1 over Cn times R, sum over H, and now I have the integral over QH of, okay, I need a bit more space, of U minus the average over QH of U. So this inequality is true now for functions which are C1. I put compactly supported to ensure that the integral converges. And now, by approximation, I extend it to set of finite perimeter in the following way. So now, apply this bound, this estimate, to the function U equal characteristic of E convolution rho epsilon. So just take the two, where E is just a bounded set of finite perimeter. And then, so you apply the inequality for these functions, and then you let epsilon goes to zero. And we know that this left-hand side converges to the perimeter. So apply this to U, and then you let epsilon tend to zero. So the left-hand side will converge to the perimeter of E. And then what happens here? So this is, I'm going to put maybe this back on the other side. So I get that Cn times R times the perimeter of E is greater or equal than the sum over H of the integral over QH. And here now I have characteristic of E minus the average over QH of the characteristic of E. So I get this information. Okay? Just took this inequality and applied to KA and let sin goes to zero. Okay, so let's now compute what is this expression. So this is sum over H. And now, so when I integrate over QH, I have two possibilities. Well, maybe let me first observe what is this. So this is the average. So this is 1 over the measure of QH. And then you have the integral of the characteristic of inside QH, which is the measure of E intersection QH. Right? Because this is 1 when point is in E and QH. So you get this integral. So this is just a number which is equal to this. Now, what is this? So characteristic of E is going to be either 0 or 1, depending whether the point is in E or not. So I have two possibilities here. Either I am inside, so I can integrate, if you want this, in QH inside E. So when I am in this set, this function is 1. So I get 1 minus E intersection QH over QH. And, okay, maybe let me rewrite this here because otherwise I don't have space. So this was E intersection QH. So I have, again, either this, or I can integrate in QH minus E. In this case, this function is 1, sorry, is 0. And then I get only this. So I get E QH over QH. But now, this, the 1, you can rewrite it as measure of QH over measure of QH. You just put at the common denominator, common factor. So you see immediately that this is actually equal QH minus E over QH. And so you have a QH minus E. Here you have a QH intersection E divided by QH. And here you have QH minus E, QH intersection E over QH. These two integrals are exactly the same. And you get a factor 2. So this is actually equal. So I go maybe slightly faster. You can recheck by yourself that this is correct. You get this. QH minus E, QH intersection E, divided by QH. So this is the formula. OK. So we discovered that the perimeter times a very small constant, if I take R very small, this I can make this as small as I want, controls this sum, which at the moment is not very peeling. It's not very clear what to do. But here comes the key point. So maybe let me draw a picture with just a big grid, just to try to understand very few cubes. So I have my set E. So this is my set E. And I want to approximate E. So the idea is the following. I want to show that E can be very well approximated with a finite, with unions of cubes. So a set which is just either one or zero inside a cube. So which cubes I want to keep to approximate E? I'm gonna say, okay, if there is at least, if E gives at least half of the measure to the cube, I take it. E gives less than half, I leave it. I don't. So I'm gonna take this, maybe this. This is too small. It's too small. This. This is enough. Maybe this as well. This. Probably this. These are the cubes that I want to keep. So the cubes that I want are the one where I have at least half of the measure, and the one I don't. The other I don't care. So, so up to reorder the cubes, I'm gonna assume the following, that E intersection QH is greater or equal than QH over 2 for every H from 1 to some number capital N, and E intersection QH is strictly less than QH over 2 for every H greater or equal than N plus 1, capital N plus 1. So I just reorder the cubes, I change names, and I'm gonna take just the ones where E gives at least mass, half of the mass. This is a finite set because E is bounded. So you cannot have this for infinitely many cubes, otherwise E would have infinite mass. So let's do it this way. So I'm just gonna take these cubes. And now the nice thing is the following, that I can keep going in the previous chain of inequality, so let me restart. So what I proved up to here is that this quantity controls that sum. But now in this sum, let me sum first up to capital N, and then, so I split in two sums, from 1 to capital N until capital N plus 1 to infinity. So I get two i's, then I have the sum from h from 1 to capital N of that quantity. But what happens here? So if I am less than capital N, you see that this is at least one half of this. So this ratio is greater than one half. So I can say that this is greater than one half. So I get one half QH minus E for the first capital N. And then for the other ones, I use the opposite inequality, that if this is less than one half, it means that this is greater than one half. So this ratio is greater than one half. So I get plus the sum from h from n plus 1 to infinity of one half QH intersection E. And now, if you define the set T to be the union of the cubes of the first capital N cubes, so this set, the yellow one, there, so just the union of the first N cubes, then you can see, so here there are some 2 and 1 half, which simplifies. And this sum is nothing else that T minus E plus, here you get E minus T. Exercise, just check. And so what we proved is that this quantity, which can be, so if this is bounded, I can make this arbitrarily small, controls the L1 distance, so this is nothing else, the characteristic of T minus characteristic of E in L1. Incidentally. So that quantity controls the L1 distance between my set E, which is also an arbitrary set of finite perimeter, and T, which is a finite union of cubes. Okay, so let me give me 3 more minutes to finish the proof, and then we make a break. So let me stop. Let me keep this. So step 3, last step. Consider the following metric space, X, R, M, to be the family of sets E, such that E is contained in VR, and perimeter of E is less or equal than M. So this is, and I'm going to put a metric, a topology, which is the L1 metric. So I consider this, the family of sets, which are bounded in VR, perimeter bounded by M, endowed with the L1 topology. And I want to prove that this set, my goal is to prove that this set is compact. How can you prove that the set is compact? You can, suffices to prove that it's closed and totally bounded. So closed, so XRM is closed by lower semi-continuity of perimeter. If you have a family of sets EK which converge to a set E, if you have a family of sets EK here in this set, which converge to a set E, well, the limiting set will be in VR, and by lower semi-continuity of the perimeter will still be less than M. So this set is closed. Totally bounded, what does it mean? It means that I can find, so totally bounded means that for every epsilon, there exists a family, finite family, F1, F capital N in XRM, such that norm of KF minus norm of KFI, let's say the minimum, I from 1 to N, this norm is less than epsilon. So it means that for every epsilon, I can find a finite set such that each element, sorry, this is true for every F in XRM. So each element F in XRM is at most a distance epsilon from one of the sets. So I have an epsilon net inside my space, finite epsilon net. So this is what I need to prove, which is very smart of my, hopefully you remember this part. So how do we prove it? So to prove it, so indeed, so why this is true? Choose R sufficiently small such that Cn times R times M is less than epsilon. Cn is the constant of Poincaré. R is the number you're choosing, and capital M is the bound of the perimeter. And then by what we proved 3 seconds ago, then for every E contained in XRM, there exists a set T, finite union of cubes of size R, such that characteristic of E minus characteristic of T in L1 is less or equal than Cn Rm, which is less than epsilon. And just observe, just note that the number of such T is finite. Right? This, since my, all my sets are in BR, I have my grid inside BR. And now, how many sets T can I construct which are union of cubes? Well, I only have finitely many possibilities. So I prove that there exists a finite set in this space. Actually, it doesn't even matter. It doesn't have necessity to be here. That's enough. Is it Well, this is true for a different m. This doesn't really matter. There exists a finite set anyhow. Then you can do by triangle inequality. There exists a finite set T such that every element E inside XRM is at most a distance epsilon from one of these. So I found a finite epsilon dense set which proved that the space is totally bounded, and then close to totally bounded implies compactness. Okay, so maybe let's take a small break, 10 minutes, and then in the next hour I will show you the isoperimetric inequality. Okay, so what we saw up to now is that with this definition of perimeter, we have two nice properties, which are lower semi-continuity and compactness. So once you have these two properties, you can kind of make the machine work and use the argument that I described at the beginning. This kind of direct method of the calculus of variation. Take a minimizing sequence, this will converge, blah, blah, blah. So remember what was our goal. So the first goal was to prove that there exists E minimizer for the problem perimeter of E, where measure of E is 1. And then the second goal would be to prove that this minimizer is a ball. So what we would like to do is to, as I said, adopt the method, the direct method of the calculus of variation to prove that there exists a solid minimizer. There is only one problem here, is that in the compactness theorem, I had an assumption, which was the boundedness, which is not given here. You see, I'm minimizing, but maybe my sets are not bounded. Now, there are two approaches here. Either you prove in your argument that you can reduce yourself to bounded sets, and it's not too complicated, but it's not trivial, pretty trivial either. So you should prove that if you take a minimizing sequence, your sequence can be bounded. Of course, you could say, I can always take balls which escape at infinity. But what you can prove is that up to take your sets and translate them back at the origin, up to a translation, your sets are bounded. And then you make the machine work. But actually, there is a simpler approach, which is the following. Instead of minimizing, consider this problem, what I'm going to do is that consider another problem. Minimize the perimeter of E. Volume of E is 1. And I'm going to put an artificial constraint, E containing BR, for some R large. So I'm going to impose in my problem that my sets are bounded inside a large ball. Why can I do it? Well, philosophically, we know that the minimizer must be a ball. So the fact that I put or not this constraint shouldn't make much of a difference, because at some moment my minimizer at the end will be a ball, so the constraint is kind of just of artificial and technical. So I'm going to consider this problem. I'm going to prove that the minimizer for this problem is a ball. And once you know that the minimizer for this problem is a ball for every R, then sometimes you just let R go to infinity. And you obtain, so there is a slightly more argument that I'm not going to do, but in some sense, once you know that this is true for every R, that the minimizer is a ball, by letting R goes to infinity, you get also the minimizer without this constraint. It's a ball. This is not going to prove that the unique minimizer is a ball, but it's going to prove that the one minimizer is a ball, which is already what you need. So I'm not going to do the quality case. I'm just saying that one of the minimizers is a ball. So we are considering this problem now with a constraint. So by compactness plus lower semi-continuity, there exists ER a minimizer. So this is just what I described at the beginning. You can try to do it as an exercise. So how do you prove that there exists a minimizer? Take a minimizing sequence. The perimeter is going to be bounded. The sets are bounded up so that you have compactness. And so up to assume they converge in L1 to something, this limiting guy will have the right volume, and by lower semi-continuity is going to be a minimizer. So comparison lower symmetry now gives us the existence of a minimizer. So goal, for us now the goal is that ER is a ball. And I'm not going to do all the details now, but I will explain to you the strategy, how to prove that the minimizer is a ball. This is based on the so-called Steiner symmetrization, which is a tool very much used in the geometric measure theory. So idea, so the first technique is Steiner symmetrization. So what is Steiner symmetrization? Steiner symmetrization is the following. So let's take some direction V, let's say on the sphere. And now I'm going to split my Rn into the space orthogonal to V, and this is the direction V. So I just take a system of coordinates. Let's say that my set is somewhere here. And now what I'm going to do is the following. So for every point Y, which is in the hyperplane orthogonal to V, I'm going to consider the line passing through Y in direction of V. I'm going to measure this intersection. And now I'm just going to copy the intersection I got here. So this is a segment, and I'm just going to copy this segment here in a symmetric fashion, more or less. So just take this length and I copy here. And I do this for every direction. So I look at this length and I copy it here. And in this way, I'm going to define a new set. Well, it's not very nice, but which is symmetric by construction with respect to the hyperplane. And such that, so as I said, for every line here, the length here is the same. Well, my picture is not here, but I hope. Whatever. Okay. Think a symmetric set where this line is equal to this line, even if you cannot see from the picture. So this new set is going to be called E S V. S by symmetrized, and V because it depends on the direction V. So for every V, you can do a symmetrization. Now, by Fubini, you have that the volume of E is equal to the volume ESV. Because the volume of E is just, by Fubini, you can compute it, and this, for every Y, you look at the length of this segment, and you integrate with respect to Y. And since you preserve the length by construction, by Fubini theorem, this volume is equal to this volume. And the key property is that now the perimeter has decreased. So this is the key property of Steiner. So claim perimeter of ESV is less or equal than the perimeter of E. So I'm going to show you very roughly the argument. I don't want to be technical on this point, because if you want to do a rigorous proof, you have to deal a lot with almost everywhere and stuff like that. But let's forget about these technical points. So let's think that there is no almost everywhere around. And let's think that our sets are nice. So this is another problem. If you try really to do the argument rigorously, you have to deal of how nice is the set. You want to use some property of sets of finite perimeter and blah, blah, blah. Let's think that the set is nice. But the general idea is the following. I mean, it just becomes more technical to do the full argument. So let me draw. So I want to prove the claim. Let me draw a piece of E. So E is this. And let's try to understand what is the perimeter of E. So let's say I just look at the perimeter in a strip here. And so I'm going to show something stronger, actually, that in every strip, the perimeter is decreased. So here I have my set E. And let's say that the perimeter can be parameterized by functions. So I'm gonna call, let's say, fi and gi, the different parts, the different function which parameterize the boundary. So f1, g1, f2, g2, and maybe I have others. What is ES? ES is gonna be some set like this. I'm gonna take the same strip here, and I have this part of the bound, so this is symmetric with respect to this line. And what is this function here? Well, so how much is this length of a segment? So the length of a segment is the difference between f1 minus g1 plus s2 minus g2 and so on. So the length is the sum of fi minus gi. So this length is the sum of the fi minus gi. But then I have half on the top, half on the bottom. So this curve is sum. Now, if you go from, so except for very rare points, every time I go, I enter, I have to exit. So I enter, so I have a G, I exit, and I have.
Yeah, but when you go 1 second to the left, you have the other case.
Well, the only case is here.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but this is a set of measure zero. Let's say this is a very exceptional set. It's a very unlikely set. It's a sense, this is like, you see, there is one point. In this case, there are 3 points where it happens. So it's. Doesn't come for the brain. So that's what I say, that there are few technical points, but in some sense, the main idea is there. So this boundary is the sum over I of phi minus gi over 2. This is the function, then I have minus it. Now, what is the perimeter? The perimeter of a graph by the area formula is, so if you give me a graph U, and you want to compute the area is, so the perimeter is 1 plus gradius square. I'm gonna use this. So in our case, what is the perimeter on the left, and the perimeter on the right? So the perimeter of E, I write perimeter of E, but really I just compute the perimeter in this strip, is the sum over I of the integral 1 plus grad phi square. This counts all these top parts. And then for the bottom, I have square root of 1 plus grad gi square. While here, so perimeter of ESV, is the integral of the square root of 1 plus the gradient. Well, gradient is sum commute, so sum of grad fi minus grad gi over 2 square. So this is the top part, and then the bottom is the same, so I put 2 in front. Okay? So this is the perimeter of the other one. And now all is behind, I just want to show that this is greater than this, and this is just a kind of a Jensen inequality. It's based on convexity. Maybe let me just very briefly do it. So behind, I'm gonna use that x, so let's say t, 1 plus t squared, square root of 1 plus t squared, this function is convex. This is what is behind. So this is a sum, let's say, up to capital N. There are capital N leaves, capital N functions. So let's see. So what I'm going to use is that the sum, let me just write it here in between, 1 plus grad phi square plus 1 plus grad gi square up to N. This is greater or equal. Then 2n, 1 over n. So I'm going to go a bit fast, and then you can recheck everything later. 1 plus grad fi minus grad gi over 2 square. And now you put d this is an average, so I'm gonna put the average inside because of the convexity. So this is greater or equal to n square root of 1 plus 1 over n sum over I of grad fi minus grad gi over 2 square. And this, you put the n inside to simplify the n, and you get, so this is greater or equal than twice square root of n plus that sum. Now you use the capital N is greater or equal than 1, say that this is greater than this. So, in some sense, it's a pointwise inequality. It's not an integral inequality. I'm just using really the integrals are pointwise, one greater than the other. So, in particular, then the total integral is greater or equal. And, okay, so once we have that, we actually discover something interesting here. So this was like all the chain of inequality that we're going to use to say that this quantity is greater or equal than this quantity. But we find something very interesting, and this is why it was crucial for us to prove first that the minimizer exists. Because if a minimizer exists, it means that whenever I take a minimizer and apply Steiner, the perimeter cannot go down because it's a minimizer. The volume is the same, so necessarily the perimeter can never go down. And if the perimeter cannot go down, I discover some information because it means that in that chain of inequality, I have equality. So what happens when I have equality? So if equality holds, the first thing you discover is that E intersection Y plus RV is a segment for every y in V pair. So in some sense here, you see I had my set E, and here I had point Y, the direction was V, and I take this intersection, and what I'm claiming is that this cannot happen if I have equality. This cannot happen because you see that here, if I have equality, here I have capital N and here I have a 1. So 1 and capital N must be the same. So it means that there was only one function. So there was never this picture. So this is the first property, that my set is, whenever I intersect with every possible line, is always a segment. And second property, so here is where the almost everywhere starts to come in and becomes delicate. And there is the second fact that you would like to say that if equality holds, actually the two sets are the same up to translation, which is not true in general. So observe that this set, so if I take this set E, and you do a Steiner symmetrization with respect to this line, you're just, even if this is like two ellipses, I mean, this is already symmetric, maybe. So you see the Steiner is going to be this. Yes. So in this case, I just translate this and translate this. So the perimeter is the same, but the sets are different because they're not just a translation. You translate it differently. So it's not true that if I have equality, my sets are the same. But it's true if the set is convex. So the second fact is that if equality holds and E is already convex, you see here is a problem that the sets are disconnected. Once you have convex, you don't have this disconnect. Then E is equal to E SV up to a translation in the V direction. So my set, essentially the only thing I did if I had equality was to translate the set down. There was nothing else. This is based on Jensen. There is a moment where you apply the inequalities from here to here, and you show that if you had equality, in some sense, the function on the top and the function on the bottom must be the same, one the opposite of the other. Otherwise, you gain something when you apply Jensen inequality. So anyhow, these are the two crucial properties which come from the proof. OK, Okay, so now we're going to apply them. And we'll see that this implies that is a ball. So let ER be our minimizer. So be a minimizer. We don't know that it's unique. No, I mean, when I do. No, I mean, if the set was like this,
yeah,
and I do a symmetrization, I get something like this.
Right.
And
but
this is.
Rotation.
It's not a rotation. No. Because
okay.
You see, the length are not even the same.
Right.
No. It's not. The only thing you can do is only a translation. Okay. So, let ER be a minimizer. Then we know that. P. Okay, let me call it E. Just I don't want to have another index here. So let E equal ER be a minimizer. So the perimeter of E is equal to the perimeter E bar. This is a dynamic. The perimeter of E bar symmetrize SV for every V. Right? So if I have a minimizer, I can do Steiner in any possible direction, and the perimeter can never go down. And so the first thing that this implies is that E bar is convex. Why? Well, you see that if my E bar was not convex, this would mean that I have two points, x1 and x2, such that the segment is not contained in between. But then just take V pointing in this direction, and you see that this contradicts the first property. If I had two points, I just contradict this fact. I could find something where there is not a set. So my set must be convex. And so now I go back here. This is convex. And I have equality. So I can apply now the second property. These two together tells me that E bar equal E bar SV plus TV for every V. So for every direction, my set is equal to itself, is equal to the symmetry, is symmetrized up to a translation. And now from this, I want to deduce this is a ball. It will be kind of easy if I didn't have the translation. So I want to get rid of this. There is all the fact that I have to translate, and that T depends on V. There is some translation which depends on the direction. Let me kill the translation in the following way. So the first thing I'm going to do is that up to a translation, we can assume that E bar S EI for every I 1 to n, where EI is the canonical basis. Why is this the case? Let me do it in two dimensions. I mean, imagine that I have my set. Let me do already if it was a ball. So what I'm saying is that, okay, if I symmetrize with respect to the first, to U1, I know that this set is equal to itself, up to a translation, and then if I symmetrize with respect to E2, is equal to itself up to a translation. So here, I have, so what I know is that the following, E bar is equal to E bar S EI plus some vector TI EI. So the TI depends on EI. And so you just define, so just apply the transformation E bar maps into E bar minus sum over I of TI EI. So just kill all the translation. First here and then here. And the point is that since the directions are orthogonal, this translation don't mess up with each other. It's not that the problem is that if you take random directions, that first you do a translation to adjust one, and then you do a translation to adjust the other, but then the second one destroys what you did for the first. But since you're doing only orthogonal translations, then in some sense you don't mess up with each other. You adjusted all the I of them. So after you subtract the set, you kill exactly the first TI, then you have that in this way. Now you have that E bar is equal to E bar SCI. And so this means that your set is symmetric. E bar is symmetric for XI maps into minus XI. So if you change, if you flip one coordinate, the set remains the same. But this means in particular that the same is true if you go from X into minus X, because you just flip one by one all the coordinates. So this implies that E bar is equal to minus E bar. The set is symmetric with respect to the origin. But now, if it is symmetric with respect to the origin, it means that there are not any more translations. So now, what do I know? E bar equal minus E bar. And then I know that E bar is equal to E bar SV plus some TV, translation which depends on V. If this is true, you can just apply a minus everywhere, and you see that the only possible T admissible is zero. Now you have a set which is symmetric with respect to the origin. There is the only possibility here is that T equals zero for every V, which implies that now E bar is equal to E bar SV for every V. And now I claim exercise E bar is a ball. The idea is very easy in some sense, because if you add, let's say, if it's not a ball, it means that you take a circle, and in some sense, they have a point here, but maybe there is no point here, so my set will be something maybe smaller than the maximal circle. So there is, this is like the maximal circle in which is included. But then, so this point is, so this is in E. Let's say I have X bar and I have Y bar. This is in E. This is not in E. And then just do a symmetrization with respect to the half plane. This point is mapped onto this one and vice versa. So if you take V orthogonal to this plane, which passes exactly in between, so this angle is equal to this angle, you see that this point is mapped to this and this point mapped to this, but this is in E, so this must be in E. So you discover that whenever there is a point, there is all the circle in inside, and then it's a ball. It's convex, and it's a ball. So small exercise here, but it's there. So the minimizer is a ball, which implies that, so what we proved, that the since the minimizer is a ball, we put that the minimum of perimeter of E, where E is 1, and E is containing BR, where R is large. We need R large just to make sure that there exists at least a set of volume 1 inside BR. That's the only reason. I mean, R must be large enough so that there exists a set. This is a number, and this is the perimeter of the ball of volume 1. So let's say B rho such that measure of B rho equal 1. And this is N. One can compute, and this is the number. And so so we put that the minimum of that is that guy. And then as I said, you have to let R go to infinity to say that actually this minimum is that guy as well. And so the minimizer is the ball, because the ball gives the number. So here there is a small argument letting R goes to infinity, but it's easy. I mean, it's not really the point. Okay. Any question? No? Okay, so I did the classical part, which is the existence of a minimizer, the fact that the minimizer for the supermetric inequality is a ball. Now we want to understand next step, which is kind of the topic of the lecture, is the stability. So we have now the ball, and we want to understand, is in some sense the ball a stable minimizer? So what do I mean by this? The kind of question I'm interested in is the following. So actually, I'm going further than where I should be, because I didn't prove that the ball is the unique minimizer. But so that's kind of cheating, because I'm gonna now work directly on something more difficult. But let's say that I proved that. So the question I want to understand, so now the stability question. Let's say that you believe me that the ball is unique minimizer. So now stability issue. So let me take again. Let E as volume 1, and let me define delta of E to be the following quantity: the perimeter of E minus N B1 1 over N. Let me write this just for coherence, but this is 1. Doesn't matter. So this is the isoperimetric inequality. What we proved is that this quantity is non-negative. And the question I claim, actually, something else. I claimed also that if delta is 0, is a ball. And then the question is, if delta of E is very small, does this imply that E is almost a ball? And I'm going to make precise this in a second. Okay, so this is the kind of stability question I'm talking about. Is it true that if my isoperimetric, if my perimeter is slightly bigger than the perimeter of the optimal guy, then I'm not far from being the optimal guy? Okay, so let me start with an example which works in dimension greater or equal than 3. So if n is greater or equal than 3, I can do the following picture. Let's say if n is equal to 3, I can do the following picture. Otherwise, you imagine it. So you take a ball, take a ball like this, and then to the ball you add a very long and tiny tentacle. Okay? And this is my set E. So what happens here? So if you take a ball and then you add this very long tentacle, what is the perimeter of the tentacle? The perimeter of the tentacle, this is like a cylinder. So the perimeter is like the length times the basis, times the perimeter of the basis. So for every length, no matter how long it is, I can always take the basis very, very, very small in such a way that the perimeter is super small. So this can have arbitrarily small perimeter. So no matter how long it is, I can always stretch enough the basis. So this works only up to the in dimension n equal to 3, because in dimension 2, the perimeter is just the length. So you have all this. It's from dimension 3 where you get to multiply by the basis, and then you can make it small. So this means that I can have a set which is just given by a ball plus a very long tentacle, and this is can have perimeter as close as I want to a ball. So this guy, so the perimeter of E can be as close as I want to the optimal guy. So this means that I can hope to say that, so delta is extremely small in this case, but I cannot hope to say that my set is uniformly close to a ball, because that's false. On the other hand, you see that to do this picture, the volume of this tentacle is extremely small. So at least in a L1 sense, I can still hope to prove something. So let me define kind of the distance between sets, the kind of quantity I want to control. So let me define A of E, which is the infimum of the symmetric difference between E and X plus B rho, where B rho is the ball which has the volume 1, which is the volume of E. Infimum among all translations. So what does it mean? So what is the symmetric difference of this? What is this? Let me explain with a picture. So I have my set E, E. Now I take a ball which can be centered at different points. So this is X plus B rho. And B or this has the same volume as E. And then I measure this. I measure the symmetric difference. Symmetric difference is this. Is the area which is not in common. Okay, this is what I want to control. So this is the Del1 norm. So this is nothing else actually that the Aptoff factor, maybe I lost some cost, but this is the same as characteristic of E minus characteristic of X plus B rho. Maybe B rho X. Ah, oh, sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. So, yeah, so what I'm measuring here is the L1 distance between E and the ball. And of course, I don't know where my set E is in space, so I take the infimum among all possible translations. Because I have to take the, my inequality will not tell me what is the set. And so the question will be, is it true that delta small implies A of V small? And this question is actually not too difficult. There is again the problem of being boundedness, or the boundedness, but you can prove it by a contradiction argument using compactness lower semi-continuity. You say, suppose that is false, it means that I have a sequence of sets such that this is going to zero, this is not going to zero. You strap that as a sequence, because the sets of finite perimeter are compact. It converges to something, and this guy is going to have this zero and this non-zero, but the only guy which have this zero is a ball. Contradiction. So that's kind of, besides the compactness with that you need to be careful about boundedness, this argument works. So it's not too difficult to prove something like this. What is more difficult is to prove something quantitative. So I don't want to prove just a qualitative statement, this small implies this small, I want to prove that this quantity controls this quantity in some explicit way. And so the kind of estimate I want to investigate is the following. So this is the first question, answer by compactness. And by contradiction. So this is not too difficult. It's in the same spirit of what we already did, I mean, compactness and so on. So now, new question is the following. Do there exist a constant C of n and an exponent alpha of n positive such that A of E is less or equal than C of N delta of E to the power alpha N. So can I find a constant depending only on the dimension and an exponent depending only on the dimension such that this A of E is controlled by constant delta of E? We can tell you delta comes because of deficit, that's how people call it, and A because of asymmetry. So just for information. This is like asymmetry. Okay, that's too many. me 3. And deficit. That's the name, the reason for the two letters. So we want a quantitative statement. We don't want to say just some, one is small, the other is smaller. Here we are saying that when delta goes to zero, A of E goes to zero in a very precise way. And so you look at this inequality, and you wonder, can this inequality be true? And usually when you want to prove such an inequality, you start with examples. And you wonder, actually, what is the best thing you can prove? So the first example you can come up with is, so remark, you can try the following example. You take in two dimensions the ball, and then you take an ellipsoid here with axis 1 plus epsilon and 1 over 1 plus epsilon. This is your set E. And then when epsilon goes to 0, you can kind of expand as a function of epsilon both quantities, the symmetry and the deficit. So you just have to compute what is this volume. And you have to compute the perimeter of an ellipsoid for epsilon small, so you can expand. And then you see, and then you plug in the power of the epsilon, which come up in both terms. These are both functions, going to be functions of epsilon. You look at the dominant terms. And then you see that alpha of n, with this example, when epsilon is very small, you see that alpha of n necessarily must be less or equal than 1 alpha. In the sense that if you plug an inequality with alpha of n greater than 1 alpha, in this example, you get something false. The epsilon don't match. You see that the exponent here, the bigger it is, the better it is. Right? So because this is a quantity going to 0, so if this is bigger, this goes to 0 faster. So you have a stronger inequality. And so here, I got an upper bound. How good can it be? Not better than 1 alpha with this example. Now, some results. What was proved? So there was a result by Fuglede that I'm going to describe to you. Maybe now just slightly sketch it, and then we'll see it better next time. So Fuglede, in 89, proved that alpha of n is equal to 1 half if E is close, very close in a strong sense, close in, we'll see, W1 infinity to B1, to the ball. So in some sense, Fuglede considered the case where your set is as nice, is as kind of a smooth perturbation of a ball, and proved that the result is true with 1 half in every dimension. Then all Hyman and Weitzman. In 91 and all 92 proved the result alpha n equal 1/4. So they could prove that in any dimension for every set the inequality is true with 1/4. And then in 2008, Fusco, Maggi and Pratelli proved the general result alpha n equal 1/2. For every case. And so here we are in 08. And then, this closed kind of this case. But then we'll see with the optimal transport proof that we did with Francesco and Aldo, one can get, again, alpha n equal 1 half, but in more general cases. General case. We'll see this. And then there is also a proof by Cicalese Leonardi that I will sketch because it's kind of short and very, it's a interesting idea which kind of connects a bit also with what you saw in some sense in Camille and then Emmanuel's lecture. So it's connected to regularity of minimal surfaces. So this is like 2012, and again, alpha n equal 1 half is a new proof, is a different proof. It's kind of much shorter, but it involves, in some sense, more results. But then it's a much shorter proof. In some sense, you have to use regularity for minimal surface. You want to use it, the proof is short. So 1 half is the optimal exponent. Maybe in 5 minutes, let me just kind of give you an idea of how you get Fugleder result. And then next time, so tomorrow, we will we'll see more details. I just want to maybe to start so that if you want, you can also try on your own sometimes to see where you can go. It's the proof is not too difficult, but it's smart in some point. But I can give you the strategy. So Fugleder. So Fugleder considered the following case. So he supposed that the boundary of E is parameterized over the sphere. So I have my sphere, let's say I'm gonna consider the unisphere. So I'm actually messing up with the volume sometimes. So here, before I say the E has volume 1, here I'm saying E is close to the volume B1. Okay, this is not volume 1. So here the volume of E is the volume of B1. Sometimes I mean, I have to fix a number. I put 1 before because I wanted 1 was more easy. Probably here is easier to fix. So what I'm using, implicitly saying here is that the volume of E has been fixed to be the volume of B1. I can always choose 1 number, right? And it's more convenient in such a way that I don't have a radius rho fixed such a way that the volume of the ball of radius B rho is 1. Either way, right? I mean, anyhow, the equality is k-invariant, just for convenience that I fix 1 volume. So here I fix this. So we assume that the boundary of E is parameterized by a function u over the sphere. So for every, you have the origin, you have the directions omega, and then you have this point, which is one plus u of omega times omega. So if u is 0, this is just omega, so this point is the sphere. And if u is not 0, then this is going to be some set like this. So is the set of points of the form 1 plus u of omega times omega, such that u in L infinity plus grad u in L infinity is less than some small epsilon. So you have a function which is small in L infinity and this gradient is small in L infinity. So this is the set I want to consider. And now the goal is to prove that the perimeter of E minus the perimeter of the unit ball is greater or equal. So of course, the volume is fixed, it'll be the same. It is greater or equal than constant integral of u square over the sphere. And then by an order inequality, this is going to control constant asymmetry of e square. So this is kind of the strategy. Prove that this is greater than this, and then show that this is greater than this. So you want to prove that inequality. How do you do? Let me just maybe sketch the strategy, so just the points, and then tomorrow we see the details. So you have to write down what is the perimeter of E. I give you the formula. So if you have a function which is parameterized over the sphere, you can write down what is the perimeter. Is the integral of 1 plus grad u square, 1 plus u square, 1 plus u to the m minus 1 integrated over the sphere. So this is the kind of area formula over the sphere. Then you take this expression and you develop. So you start to do an expansion in U. So you get that this is, you have the dominant term is 1, So this is the perimeter of the unit ball when you put one everywhere. Then you're going to get something like, so tomorrow we're going to see it, but just something like this term gives you something like integral of grad u squared over 2. And then you have terms in u, m minus 1 integral of u. And then you get plus m minus 1, m minus 2 over 2, the integral of u squared, plus lower order terms. Well, lower order terms, I mean terms which you can reabsorb with some epsilon around. So this is kind of the perimeter. And now you want to see that this quantity is coercive. This quantity, this error, the deficit, allows you to control u squared. This is not completely obvious. First, you see that this is quadratic and this is linear. So how you get rid of the linear term? The idea there is two more minutes. So since the measure of E, again, is equal to the measure of B1, you discover that the integral over the sphere of 1 is equal to the integral over the sphere of 1 plus u to the n. This comes from the equalizing the volumes. And then you develop this in n, so you get at the first order, so you see the first order is 1, so the 1 simplifies. Then you get a term in u squared, and then lower order. And then the strongest term is the first and the second, and the sum must be 0, because the 1 has canceled. So in some sense, you see that the first, so you get 0 is more or less n integral of u plus n m minus 1 over 2 integral of u squared. And there are lower order terms. And then you use this information to plug in here and get, here you use this to get a term in u squared there. And say you get the perimeter of E minus perimeter of B1 is something like up to errors, grad u squared over 2 minus m minus 1 integral of u squared over 2 plus small errors, something like this. And now you look at this inequality and you say, okay, if this quantity controls this quantity, I'm done. So I'm trying to have I'm using a kind of a Poincaré inequality on the sphere. I want that the gradient controls the function. The gradient in L2 must control the function in L2. Okay, usually when you have a Poincaré inequality, you want a mean zero condition, because otherwise you put a constant, this is zero, this is non-zero. But the mean zero condition is implicit almost here, because if you see that this, you think this is a lower order term, because this is u is very small, so this you see, okay, the integral of u is approximately zero. U is some lower order term. So in some sense, u cannot be that big. And in fact, you can also see it here. U cannot be a constant. The only constant for which this inequality is true is zero. So we are in good shape because u cannot be a constant. So u cannot be the first counterexample to this inequality. Then you say, okay, what is the Poincaré inequality on the sphere when I have functions which are not constant? There is a Poincaré inequality on the sphere, and it has a constant, which is exactly m minus 1. So the Poincaré inequality on the sphere tells you exactly that this quantity is non-negative. Nothing better. That's the best you can see. But in some sense, you have this inequality, which a priori you can say only non-negative, and then you have errors, which could go all in the wrong on the wrong direction. So in some sense, here you're kind of stuck because this is a sharp inequality on the sphere. Why? Well, tomorrow we'll discuss better. But so this means that it looks that you're stuck, that you cannot get anything out of this. But then you remember one other thing, that you have still 1 degree of freedom in this parameterization, is to say, okay, my set is here, but is there a sphere better than another with respect to whom I can parameterize myself? Maybe I was stupid, my set is just exactly a ball, and I just took a ball I took a, I have the unit ball, and my set was just a translation of a ball and parameterizing myself with respect to another ball. So in a sense, I'm stupid because u is zero in that case. You see, I should have parameterized myself with respect to myself, not with respect to another ball. Because then u was zero, but I'm not seeing it, that I'm zero. So you say, okay, so then I can choose a better ball. And which one can be the best? Okay, let's say I take the same body center. So you can say, okay, among all possible balls with respect to whom I can be parameterized, let me choose the ball for which I have the same body center. So you impose that the integral, let's say, of on the boundary of E, for instance, of X, you can always impose that this is the same as the integral B1 of X, the function X. So in a sense, you fix the body center on the boundary. This can always be done up to translation. Once you impose that, you have an extra condition, which we're going to see gives you a better Poincaré inequality in the sphere. And once, because you're going to be orthogonal to the first eigenfunctions on the sphere, and once you're orthogonal to the first eigenfunction on the sphere, the constant for this inequality is not anymore n-1, it's going to be 2n. And here, this becomes that this quantity is strictly positive and controls u squared. So there's going to be an argument of parameterizing with respect to a better one. But OK, for today, I think it's enough. So I stop here.